everybody. Welcome back to the RSAC reception here in the Embarcadero. We're at Lamar with Open Policy and Anishin. You're watching theCUBE. It's, at some point, it's going to be after dark, but I always call it theCUBE after dark when we do these at night. My name is Dave Vellante. John Furrier's on his way. I'm here with Joe Nicastro, who's field CTO at Legit Security.
Yeah, appreciate
you guys are legit.
Yeah,
we had you on
quit,
at the
right?
New York Stock Exchange.
Yeah.
And we're talking about supply chain security, hot topic. The DevOps CI/CD pipeline, you guys. But give us the bumper sticker on Legit.
Yeah, absolutely. So so largely we play in the application security posture management space, or ASPM. You know, we're helping organizations of all sizes really help solve for a few different problems, right? First is really finding a number of their risks within their overall organization. Secondarily, we're helping them fix those, right? And a lot of that comes down to helping them prioritize what they should be fixing first based on a lot of the business context that typically is not being found within those application security tools that they're traditionally using. And then lastly, we're helping them prevent a lot of these risks from coming into the overall environment so that not only are they able to remediate faster, but also so that they're able to, again, prevent some of these things from actually getting into the overall CI/CD pipeline or their overall applications before they become a problem.
So a lot of times when people have this conversation, they think that what you do slows down development. I'm guessing you're going to argue it actually accelerates, but I want you to explain that,
yeah,
because it's non-intuitive to folks.
Yeah, so we absolutely help speed it up, right? And we do this in a couple of different ways. One, we actually give developers tools within their own environment to help them assess and understand, you know, what is the best practices as I go forward. We can also help to put in guardrails so that as developers hit those guardrails, we can start to bounce them back and you know, redirect them in the appropriate ways. But then secondarily, we really help speed up the pace of development and fixing remediation and vulnerabilities because we're essentially helping organizations understand which of those vulnerabilities are the most pressing to their environments, right? Typically, when we talk to larger organizations, they've got tens, hundreds, you know, billions of vulnerabilities that they need to go about remediating, and oftentimes the struggle is figuring out which of those vulnerabilities they should be prioritizing because it actually offers business risk to that organization, right? And so not only are we helping by prioritizing what they should be focused on, but then secondarily helping them understand what can I deprioritize within my overall environment because it's not a factor in risk within our organization, and therefore maybe I don't need to have my developers expend that time in trying to get these things fixed.
So whenever you talk about developer and security, the phrase shift left comes up, but a lot of organizations, they struggle with whether it's culture or expertise or knowledge of tools, et cetera. Where do you guys see, you in your field CTO work, where do you see the friction points and how are you helping customers address that?
It's a great question, right? So I would say one of the major friction points is oftentimes giving the developer all of the information they need to understand why this risk is important, right? For years, we've largely pushed vulnerabilities to developers and said, hey, you need to fix this because it's got a CVSS score of X, or it's a criticality of high or something like that. But oftentimes, these are arbitrary criticalities that are given to a vulnerability based on the way that vulnerability sits in the outside world, right? It's not actually taking a look at the vulnerability within your own business structure and different things that you might have in place, such as mitigations or exacerbated risk, like whether that vulnerability is touching things like sensitive data, et cetera, right? And so where we help developers meet the security teams is by giving them all that context that's needed to make those decisions, right? Not only can we tell you, hey, that you have a SQL injection, but we can start to do things like say, you got a SQL injection that's sitting on top of an API that's internet exposed, touching sensitive data on one of your highest, most business critical applications, and that's the reason why you should fix it, right? And giving that developer that context really helps them feel a motivation to get this fixed as opposed to just giving them an arbitrary, hey, this CVSS is a 9 and therefore you should fix it, which in the developer world really means nothing to them.
So, Joe, the whole supply chain security, the posture management, it seemed to evolve. I mean, it seemed like the SolarWinds incident was a catalyst. There were others, Log4j as well, but it's evolved. The whole posture management, you know, big trend. I mean, obviously companies like Wiz got a lot of headlines on that. Some people poo-poo it. What's the, from your perspective, from a customer point of view, What was the genesis here? How did we get to this point?
Yeah, so I mean, for Legit specifically, we were largely born out of a lot of the SolarWinds issues, right? What our founders realized was there's a lot of application security tools out there that are looking at the posture of your application, looking at the posture of where that application is sitting in your production environment, but there's really a missing area in actually analyzing your build pipelines and the software factory that creates these applications in order to understand where that risk is, right? And I think we've seen this lack of analysis in this area, which is the reason why you've seen a lot of these software supply chain attacks increase over the last 5, 6, 7 years that we've kind of seen them come to fruition, right? And I would say, you know, from that, we've actually kind of molded that into what we consider is a complete ASPM, or Application Security Posture Management platform, because now not only are we looking at the application and the production environments, but again, we're also looking at that entire software factory. So we actually see the entire build of that application, what that application looks like after it's built, and then where that application is sitting in the production environment, and can assess that risk across the holistic software factory,
awesome.
Or SDLC.
That's awesome. Another question, how is Legit, and how are your customers and your tech peers in your community, how are they evolving to deal with things like AI-generated code, or this whole agentic wave, or machine-to-machine? You know, think about all the injection points, you know, along that supply chain, it's exploding. How are you evolving to address that?
Yeah, so from our perspective, we're helping organizations, A, with the visibility problem of AI, right? Where do I have AI being utilized within my environments? And whether that's utilizing your own LLMs or connecting into things like open AI such as ChatGPT, or even just utilizing things like generative AI, Copilot, et cetera. So that's the first step for us, right? Where do I have these particular tools? And then secondarily, we can start to help implement controls in these areas where this AI is being utilized, right? Again, it comes down to an understanding of where that risk is and how many of these particular risks come together to make a problem, right? The example that I like to give is a developer utilizing a ChatGPT or a cursor or some kind of generative AI tool is a risk in and of itself, but it's often a risk that most organizations are willing to take because it makes them more innovative, right? But when we start to see those generative AI tools being utilized in things like pipelines without code review or other types of controls, that's where we can start to pinpoint issues and say, hey, you know, this might be a little bit more of a risky proposition than you're willing to take as an organization. How can we help you implement some of these controls to make sure that you're utilizing these tools in an appropriate way or in a safe manner?
When you're out in the field,
yeah,
working with customers, what's the two-part question? What's the hardest problem that these customers are facing, and what's your favorite problem to solve?
Yeah, that's a really great question. I would say probably the hardest problem that most of them are trying to solve for right now is the inundation of vulnerabilities that they have, and understanding which of those vulnerabilities actually offer business risk to them, and where they should be putting forth effort for remediating these things, mm-hmm. right? I think it's something that everybody really struggles with. They've all got SAST and DAST and SCA and CSPM tools, et cetera. We've gotten really, really good at finding alerts, right, or finding issues in the environment. What we're not really good at as a space or as a vertical is understanding which of those particular vulnerabilities are going to affect my business as a whole, and which of those I should really be putting engineering resources at getting fixed. I would say, from my perspective, the most fun problem that we solve for is really helping organizations break down a lot of those cultural barriers that you typically see within, like, developers and security, right? We've moved towards something that we call DevSecOps, which is supposed to break down those silos, and I think we've done a good job at it, but you still have a cloud security team and a product security team and a vulnerability management security team, and so you've got all of these still, you know, these siloed entities across an organization that oftentimes aren't speaking the same language or don't have all of the context that each of these groups need.
That's really interesting, the whole cultural thing. Of course, we love technology, but it's always the culture that's one of the biggest challenges. And you're right. You know, you think about the cloud came in, like, I wouldn't say out of nowhere, but it came in hot and heavy on two wheels. And then all of a sudden it became the first line of defense. And then, oh, shared responsibility, oh, developers have to shift left and solve this problem, oh, and compliance and auditors looking over my shoulder. And all of a sudden now, AI comes in, you've got all these things to deal with. So you, just listening to you talk about that, the first challenge, the most difficult challenge, I think a lot of people are hopeful that, well, first of all, because of AI, that problem becomes, you know, impossible, right, for humans to solve alone. So the hope is that AI, automation, is the only way and the way to solve that problem. But as we all know in this industry, it's always a game of cat and mouse.
Very much so.
So I feel like right now the adversaries, because of AI, have the advantage and the industry is catching up. Is that unfair?
I would say, you know, AI can, like any other tool, be used for good and bad, right? I think obviously adversaries are very much using AI to understand, you know, where can I be use pointed attacks, where should I be looking at to get into these organizations. But I think in that same note, AI for the defenders is really good at finding that signal from the noise, right? When you get large vulnerability data sets, understanding that context within those particular data sets to understand where, again, should I focus and find that signal, I think AI does a really good job at this, right? A good example, one of the things that we offer is a secrets detection tool, right? Where we can go through entire environments in an organization and understand where do you have secrets that are being exposed. Problem with this is that oftentimes it's a very difficult problem to solve and there's a lot of false positives. And so we've actually implemented our own AI and LLMs internally to actually go through that data set to understand where do we see false positives, again, so that we can deprioritize those and help organizations understand where they have real secrets that they need to go about remediating.
Yeah, makes sense. Well, Joe, really appreciate the time and the good work that you're doing in the field. Thanks so much for coming on theCUBE.
Appreciate it. Thanks so much for having me. It was a pleasure.
Okay, this is Dave Vellante. John Furrier is also in the house. You're watching theCUBE at RSAC with Open Policy and the NYSE. We'll be right back, right after this short break.